Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Sai Naik Desai from Goa Medical College. And today I am going to present case report on neurotoxoplasmosis in a seropositive patient. So Toxoplasma gondii is an intracellular protozoan parasite which is seen to cause severe infections in an immunocompromised patient such as patients living with HIV AIDS, whereas it is seen to cause subclinical infection in an immunocompetent patient. Currently, these patients have highly put on combination antiretroviral therapy, which is seen to cause decrease in both morbidity and mortality. Now, our patient is a 40-year-old female presented to emergency room with bilateral frontal headache and a solitary episode of seizure. 12 years earlier, she was diagnosed with HIV infection. She was put on highly active antiretroviral therapy, but she was non-compliant for past 2 years. Soon after the admission, patient developed high-grade fever, but otherwise her other vitals were stable. There were no neurological deficits. Lumbar puncture was normal. CD4 counts were 186 cells per microliter. Immunological and biological studies shows increased CRP, and one patient was positive for Toxoplasma IgG antibody. CT scan was performed at casualty level, which shows multiple hypodense lesions with a hyperdense ring with surrounding perilesional edema. Hypodensity was also noted in the left frontal region. Further evaluation was performed with MRI. On T1 weighted images, hypointense lesions with hyperintense rim were noted in the left caudate nucleus and the right globus pallidus. T2 weighted images revealed hyperintensity in bilateral basal ganglia with extensive perilesional edema. A lesion was noted in the left frontal region with concentric areas of hyperintensities and a hypointense ring with surrounding perilesional edema. FLAIR imaging showed this concentric alternating zone of hyperintense and hypointense signal in the left frontal region with associated perilesional edema. Hyperintensities were also noted in bilateral basal ganglia and the right temporal region. It was also seen to involve left hemipons, left medial lobe of temporal bone, left basic frontal region, and bilateral cerebral hemisphere. On post-contrast studies, this region shows a ring enhancement. Coming to discussion, neurotoxoplasmosis is a common opportunistic infection which is seen in immunocompromised patients such as HIV/AIDS. Imaging helps in timely treatment. Toxoplasmosis is caused by Toxoplasma gondii, which is intracellular protozoan, and it is transmitted to humans primarily by the ingestion of cysts through the undercooked meat or the direct contact with the cat's feces. Most infections are seen when the CD4 counts drop below 200 cells per microliter. Clinical features varies from vague indolent to highly reactive acute encephalitis in immunocompromised patients, whereas in immunocompetent patients, this acute encephalitis is extremely rare. Imaging features will manifest as multiple lesions with a predilection for the basal ganglia, thalami, corticomedullary junction, and cerebellum. The average size of these lesions range from 2 to 3 cm, however, larger lesions are also noted. CT scan findings shows multiple ill-defined hypodense lesions predominantly in the basal ganglia, thalami, corticomedullary junction, and rarely may involve posterior fossa. It is associated with moderate to marked perilesional edema. On CCT, this shows ring or nodular enhancement in most of the cases. However, the enhancement depends on the status of the CD4 counts. If the CD4 counts are less than 50 cells per microliter, the enhancement is minimal or absent. The calcification in neurotoxoplasmosis is rare. However, in some cases, post-treatment, there may be dot-like or thick and chunky type of calcifications. Double-dose delayed CCT scan shows central filling in delayed images. Coming to MRI findings, these lesions appear iso to hypo-intense or T1-weighted images. And hyperintense ring may be seen in case of hemorrhage or necrosis on T1-weighted images. Variable signal intensity is noted on T2 and FLAIR images. There may be areas of concentric alternating areas of hyperintensity and hypo or iso-intense signals on T2 FLAIR images, which is termed as concentric target site. It is associated with extensive perilesional vegetative edema. On DWI imaging, the lesions do not restrict. However, there may be some peripheral restriction noted. On post-contrast scan, dream-like or nodular enhancement is noted. Occasionally, there can be eccentric enhancing nodule in a ring-enhancing lesion called as eccentric target cell. And this enhancing nodule represents the collection of the concentrically thickened vessels. MR spectroscopy reveals lipid lactate peaks and reduced choline levels. PET scan and thallium spec shows no uptake. Coming to differential diagnosis, the most important differential diagnosis for neurotoxoplasmosis is primary CNS lymphoma. Another important differential diagnosis includes cerebral metastasis and other infective focus. So how do we rule out neurotoxoplasmosis versus lymphoma on imaging? So there will be multiple lesions in neurotoxoplasmosis, whereas in CNS lymphoma, it is usually solitary. The location in neurotoxoplasmosis includes basal ganglia, thalamus, corticomedullary junction, and rarely the posterior fossa. Whereas in CNS lymphoma, it shows subependymal spread, including the periventricular white matter and corpus callosum. Enhancement pattern is ring and nodular in neurotoxoplasmosis, where the strong heterogeneous is CNS lymphoma. Neurotoxoplasmosis lesions do not restrict, whereas in case of CNS lymphoma, it restricts. Hemorrhage within the lesion is more common in neurotoxoplasmosis compared to the CNS lymphoma. ADI will show high value in neurotoxoplasmosis, whereas low value in CNS lymphoma. MR spectroscopy will show choline peak on CNS lymphoma, which is not seen in neurotoxoplasmosis, whereas PET scan and thallium spec will be cold for neurotoxoplasmosis and will be hot for CNS lymphoma. And these are my references for my paper presentation. Thank you very much.